salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for the gods of the nations are idols. But the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy in his dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. The word is firmly established and cannot be moved. Let the heavens rejoice and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Then the trees of the forest will sing. They will sing for the joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Cry out, save us, O God, our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name, that we may glory in your praise. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Then all the people say, Amen.
Thank you.
Please bow your heads with me as we pray together. Dear Lord, our God, how great you are. Lord, your mercies are new every morning. Lord, we thank you for your mercies and your grace today. Lord, we thank you for the beautiful sun this morning. We thank you for this gathering, this fellowship together here. Lord, we are your people, the body of Christ. Lord, help us to be your hands and your feet in this world. Lord, we think of our missionaries, David and Jennifer, who are serving in the Africa region. Oh, Lord, we pray that you would bless their ministries, both here today and Lord, through offerings that are given through the World Evangelism Fund. Lord, it is amazing we can connect with our missionaries through prayer and through monetary offering to help them succeed in sharing the gospel and helping find the lost and serving the needy and the poor. Lord, for you are a God who saves. You offer life. You offer freedom. This world only offers sin that binds us in chains and tells us we are not good enough. But Lord, you say we are yours. We are your creation. We are your people. Lord, this morning we pray as we give in our tithes and our offerings. Lord, help us to be your obedient children who love you. Lord, we ask all these things in your holy name.
Thank you.
praise become our embrace, become our words that we speak to others. But Lord God, in grumbling and complaints, as Pastor Wright preached last week, Lord, let your praise and your words flow from our hearts to our lips. Oh, Lord. Lord, this morning we lift our praises and our prayer requests to you. Lord, for our missionaries, for our people, for our shut-ins, for those who are in the hospital. Lord, you know each and every situation. And Lord, you are there with them, just as you are here with us. Lord, this morning, would you anoint Pastor Will as he preaches, just as you've already anointed him this week and over at Hope Church this morning. Lord, we are thankful for the communication and the connection that we have with our sister church here in Battle Creek. Lord, we are thankful for the First Kids Learning Center. Lord, how each day they reach out to the children in our community so that they may go and tell their parents about Jesus.
Yes.
Lord, I pray that you would help us to connect with those families at the summer extravaganza coming up. Lord, to not just pray for them, but to meet hands and feet that talk to them and get to know them. Lord, we thank you for His Hands Ministries and the wonderful leader that Peggy May is with the dreams that she has for this place. Lord, for missions is across the world, but missions is also right here in Battle Creek, Harbor Creek community.
Yes.
And Lord, missions happens at Hope Church and at our church, but Lord, missions can happen in our backyard, getting to know our neighbors, getting to know the lady at Starbucks, getting to know the person that works at the gas station. Lord, let justice and praise become our embrace. As we speak of who you are to others, as we speak life in this world of darkness. Lord, we thank you for who you are. Lord, for you are holy, you are glory, you are worthy of all of our praise. We pray all of this morning in your holy name.
Maybe see.
So, I'm just going to jump right into it. Not much fruit. When interpreting the scriptures, context is key. You need to know what's going on before the text, and it's extremely helpful to know where the text you're reading leads afterwards. You need the whole picture. And so I'm going to give you a little bit of context today. It's also good to know historical context. And some of that would be, who wrote it? Who did they write to? What was going on at the time? What was the political climate? Who are the people who received it? Were they wealthy? Were they more economically depressed? Did they live in the city or in more rural areas? Who received this? Context is helpful if we're to understand the text. And so I thought that today I would give you some context. The Apostle Paul wrote the book of Romans. That's not really news to most of you. But the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Romans. And Paul, he was a Jewish man. In fact, he was a Pharisee who believed that by following the law, the Jewish people would be welcomed by God at the resurrection to come. He believed that so much that he persecuted the Christian church because they were not following the law of God, or so he thought. And I'm just giving you a real brief version of this story. One day, he was riding down the road, and God spoke to him and actually caused him to become blind. And Christ himself spoke to, his name was Saul at the time, said, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And then we fast forward a little while later, and Paul, he can now see again. It says that the scale-like things fell off of his eyes, and he can now see again. But he sees more than just physically now. He can see spiritually. He's been given spiritual eyes. Jesus himself taught Paul what it is to be a follower of Christ. What it is to have faith that Jesus saves, not the law. Christ himself saves. And that was a message that the Apostle Paul could not shake. It entered into the very depths of his soul that Jesus Christ saves, not the law. And it was so powerful that it was the message he wanted to share with everyone. And so he tried his best. He traveled all over the place, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. And so he writes to the church at Rome, this letter that we call Romans. And Paul had never been to this church. Unlike all the other letters he writes, he didn't start this. Other letters he wrote, he started those churches. He didn't start this one. He's never been there. He's never met them. But he had hoped to visit them. And he wanted to make his way to Spain, so that the people in Spain could hear the good news, the gospel that Jesus Christ saves. But if he was going to get to Spain and proclaim salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, he was going to need some help. He knew that an evangelist, you can accuse the Apostle Paul of a lot of things, but being dumb is not one of them. He knew that if he was going to go to Spain and evangelize the people there, he could not do it on his own. He was going to need some help. And so he writes to this church in Rome, and he didn't only write to them because he needed their help. He knew that they needed this mission, that maybe more than the people in Spain. He knew how badly this church in Rome needed to get back on mission. And I'm hoping that you've read the book of Romans, and if not, give it a chance. It is a powerful book. The Spirit will cut right to your heart, move you as you read it. And we love this book. Christians, for a long, long time, this is one of the most loved books of the Bible. But lost in our love, in the book of Romans, are the problems that this church faced. We remember the church at Corinth. I believe that you have been hearing some messages from 1 Corinthians. Did they have problems, or did they have problems? Wow. And many, many problems. And we can read and we know about some of the issues in Ephesus. And in Galatia, and on and on, Paul writes letters to churches that had problems. But we don't often think about the problems that the church at Rome was facing. And problem number one was this. They weren't all the same. Now you're probably thinking, that's not a problem. That's the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God says people of all different types can come together and be in his kingdom. But it was a problem for them. Again, context is key. The church at Rome, it originally was started with Jewish converts to the faith. The church in Rome consisted mostly of people who were of Jewish ethnicity and had come to believe in Jesus Christ. And so that's the people who are sitting out there. I don't know how they exactly structured their worship service, but we'll pretend they had pews. It was all the people in the pews. Almost all of them were of Jewish ethnicity. But then the Emperor Claudius, he was a Roman emperor, he decided that for different reasons he did not like the Jews. And so he said, all of you, pack your bags, get out. We don't care where you're going, but you can't stay here. All the Jews had to leave Rome. So what does that mean for the church? Close the doors? No, not at all. What happened was Gentile believers began to fill the church, and praise be to God for that. The church there didn't end, but Gentile believers ended up comprising most of the congregation after the Jews were kicked out of Rome. And so we fast forward several years. I probably should have looked up how many. We fast forward several years, and the Jews are now allowed to come back into Rome. And there's much celebrating. These Jewish believers, they're excited. We get to go back to our church. Imagine that you have been kicked out of Battle Creek, and you can't come to First Church of the Nazarene. You've been gone for years, and then finally you're allowed to come back. You're thinking, I'm ready to go to church. I'm ready to see my church family and worship where I've worshiped for so long. You're almost bursting at the seams with excitement. And so it was with them. They were ready to go back to church, the church that they have been a part of. So excited. We get to go back to our church. I can't wait to sing all of our old songs. I can't wait to see that wall that I helped build 30 years ago and we never painted. So many memories. This is going to be great. So they show up for church. But it doesn't seem so great anymore. The Gentile believers, well, they don't sing the same songs that we used to sing. In fact, they're too loud, and we have to turn our hearing aids down or take them out completely. And they liked the blue cushions on the seats, but we liked the green ones. And they painted that wall that we put up 30 years ago, which is great because now I don't have to do it, except they picked the ugliest color in the world. And they take communion at the end of service, but we liked it in the middle. And we like the blinds to be open so that there's natural light come in and illuminate things, but they like them closed so that it's a little cooler in the sanctuary. And we really liked our old pastor. He was great. He preached 3 points in a poem, and then closed service with an altar call every single Sunday. And this new pastor, he's okay, but he only has 1 point. And that's if we can even follow where that 1 point is, because he doesn't wear a suit, and it's so distracting. And they have no respect for our traditions. I don't think we can worship together. We built this church. We were here first. They're just going to have to change back to our ways or else get out. This is our church. So I realize that I might not be invited back here after some of this tongue-in-cheek a little bit. But I just offended probably 50% of you, and another 25% would have been offended if you were listening. The other 25%, hold on, your time is coming. 50% is a failing grade, so I'm trying for more. The Jewish believers, they weren't the only ones complaining. They weren't the only ones who were upset. The Gentile believers had qualms of their own. But how dare you come back here and tell us that we're doing things wrong? We may not have the same ancestry as you, but this is our church. This is our church now. We've got the rocking music that you can literally feel. And we don't know if that's the Holy Spirit or the bass turned way up, but you can feel it. And our children's program is top notch. Our youth are bursting at the seams because we have the cool factor going on. We're modern, we're hip, we don't care about your traditions. This is our church. Get with the times or get out. So see, I'm an equal opportunity offender. I superimposed some of the problems of today's church on this church of old, but the point remains the same. They could not get along because of traditions and the ways of doing new things had divided them. They had become distracted by the little things. So Paul writes this letter, and he takes the first 8 chapters of Romans, and he's writing to the Jewish believers and the Gentile believers, And part of me wants to say that he's writing to the Gentiles to tell them how they've been included, but he's equally writing to the Jewish believers to tell them that's your family too. And so at Hope Church, I've been preaching through Romans for almost 2 months now. And I just need to give you a synopsis of where we've been. And I'm hitting the highlights of the sermons. There's a whole lot more to it, but follow with me. We started in Romans chapter 5, and here's what I told the people that day. Here's what Paul tells us. It's all gift. Christ has saved you. Christ is saving you, and that is gift too. He writes, well, he tells us that we've been justified through faith, and that faith is in the fact that Jesus saves. That's what our faith is in. The fact that Jesus saves us, and that is a gift from God. Paul writes, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. And then a few verses later, he says, God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It's all gift. Not when you became good enough, he died. While you were still sinners, he died for you. It's all gift. Even while we were still sinners, I can't say it enough, Christ died for us. He loves us that much. That's how much he loves us. And he didn't wait for us to get everything together, but instead he came to us. So that's the very, very brief chapter 5. Chapter 6, this is what we're told. We have received new life, so let's live in it. We've received this great gift, so let's live in it. Count yourselves dead to sin, but alive in Christ. Paul, chapter 5, he says, you've been given this gift. It's free. You don't have to earn it. And then in chapter 6, he says, what's your response? What's your response to this gift? It is to live into it, which is to be dead to sin, but alive in Christ. And hear me, that's not to say that we never sin again. If someone tells you, well, I've been saved and sanctified, and I never sinned again, they just did. They lied to you. But here's what's true. We don't have to sin. We do not have to sin. Sin does not have power over us. The power of the Holy Spirit is stronger than the power of sin. Christ defeated the powers of sin and death. And so through him, we can say no to sin. We do not have to be slaves to it. We have been set free. We can say no to sin. So let's live in the redemptive work of God. That's what Paul tells us in chapter 6. And then we get to chapter 7. And most people read through Romans and get to chapter 7 and they stop. Because that chapter, it's confusing. It messes with your mind. Paul, he enters into this monologue, and I'm not going to quote it verbatim, but he says, what I want to do, I do not do. And what I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. What I do not want to do, I do. And I hate this. I can't do what I want to do. And he even is so in so much anguish, he says, woe is me. I'm the worst. And in that chapter, what Paul is trying to tell us, once again, is that the law can't save you. He said, I tried. I tried to live by the law. What I wanted to do, I didn't do it. The very thing I was trying not to do, I kept on doing it. And he ends, though. I preached on chapter 7, and it just doesn't seem like very good news. In fact, I'm pretty sure most people left depressed that day. And I encourage them to come back the next week, because we're getting into the good stuff. And in chapter 7, Paul says, this is the message. You cannot do it. You cannot do it. The law can't do it. You can't do it. You cannot be good enough. But thanks be to God, Jesus Christ saves us. I use your manuscript my whole sermon, but I'm not today. I have a decent amount of manuscript, but I'm trying to stretch myself a little bit. And so you got to bear with me. I'm going to be all over the place for a while. Paul, in chapter 7, he says you can't do it. You cannot. And he even goes so far as to say, it's not me, but it's sin in me doing it. And we need to hear that rightly. He's not saying, I'm not guilty. It's just sin in me. I didn't do it. That's not what he's saying. But he's saying, sin has become so much a part of my life. And I use this image of cancer, this tumor that grows tentacles, and it weaves its way into you, so much so that when the doctor looks into it, they say, it's so enmeshed with the good flesh, we don't know where the good starts and the bad starts. We don't even know how to get at it. And so it is when sin enters us. It becomes so much a part of us that, like Paul, we could say, it's not me, it's sin in me. It's become so much a part of me that I don't even know where I am and sin is. And so again, he's not saying I'm not guilty, but he's saying sin became so much a part of me that I can't even distinguish between me and sin. It is me. And then again, like I said, he ends with thanks be to God. And we get to chapter 8. And I think I bit off more than I could chew when we started chapter 8. I tried to preach on Christmas, Good Friday, Easter, and Pentecost all in one Sunday. And of course, I didn't do justice to any of them. But the point was this. Once again, it's all gift. Christmas is a gift from God. That Christmas being the sending of Jesus Christ. God taking on flesh to make his dwelling among us is a gift. Good Friday, where Christ dies for us, is a gift. And Easter, the resurrection of Christ, which tells us that we too have hope of resurrection, both now and in the age to come, is a gift from God. And Pentecost, the sending of the Holy Spirit, and I say this at Hope a lot, the gift of salvation is the Holy Spirit. Christ came, he died, he rose, so that the Spirit could be sent to us. We have God with us, Emmanuel, even today. And so it's Pentecost. And the continuing effects of it are all gift. And then he continues on and he says, Do not be governed by the mind of the flesh, but be governed by the mind of the Spirit. What does he mean by that? The mind governed by the flesh is selfish. And it says, me. Me, me, what do I get? What's in this for me? How can I be glorified? How can I get more? But the mind governed by the Spirit says, how can I bring glory to God? How can I love my neighbor because God loves me? How can I love them in that same way? And so Paul says, do not be governed by the mind of the flesh. Don't worry about yourself, but be governed by the mind of the Spirit which leads to life. And I'm almost at chapter 8. We're getting there. I promise you I'm going to preach on Romans chapter 9. Paul continues on, and he says, the Gentiles have been adopted into the family of God, anyone who believes has been made co-heirs with Christ. And because of that, we begin to see some of the recreation that God has in store. Some of the restoration that God has in store. The things that were broken when sin entered the world, God is redeeming. He's bringing them back to his original intent. And part of that is that everyone would come to know salvation in Christ. And Gentiles are included into that. They've been adopted. And then he goes on to say that we groan. The creation itself is groaning as if in the pains of childbirth. And he says, we who have the first fruits of the Spirit are groaning. And he says, the Spirit himself groans for us. What is this groaning? It's a cry that God would restore, that he would redeem, that he would set things right. And I wish I could preach that one right now. It was too good. Not because of me, but it was just a good one. And God is setting things right, and we long for that. We don't even have words to express the feelings we have when we say, Lord, make it right. Lord, set people free from the bondage of sin. We don't have words. All we can do is groan. And even creation is groaning, longing to be made as it was in the very beginning when God created the heavens and the earth. So Paul says, we groan too. We groan for everything. Everyone to be made new. So this is good news. This is really good news. Actually, I should have heard some more amens there. But this is really good news. The Gentiles are now part of God's family. And so if you think back to what I started this sermon with, sort of a tongue-in-cheek, they weren't getting along. The Gentile believers and the Jewish believers were not getting along. And so Paul says the Gentiles have been brought into the family, but you can imagine that the Jewish believers sitting there and thinking,
for us? What does that mean for us? Because, you know, we have this history that God has been faithful to us. What does this mean for us? And in fact, Paul ends chapter 8, and he talks about not being separated from God. I'm going to read those to you because they are really, really powerful words. Romans chapter 8, beginning in verse 31. Paul says, "What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship, or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And now here are these Jewish believers thinking, sure does seem like we're being separated. So Paul writes this book, this letter, and in chapter 9, So Paul reminds them that God, to these people who are wondering, have we been separated? He reminds them that God has been faithful to them throughout history. God has been faithful. He says in verses 4 and 5, theirs is the adoption to sonship. Theirs is the divine glory, the covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah, who is God over all forever. And so Paul reminds them, God's been faithful. And throughout history, God has been faithful to you. Remember his glory? Remember that great pillar that went before you when he brought you out of Egypt? The glory of God that was before you? He was faithful, wasn't he? Remember the covenants? The very promises that God made? And you weren't that faithful. But God was. And remember the patriarchs? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, whom God gave his promise and renewed his covenants with. Did he ever abandon those? And then he ends it with Christ. So remember that the human ancestry of Christ comes from your people. It is Christ who fulfills all of these things. God is still faithful, and it is so much more faithful than your puny imaginations could even begin to conceive. So faithful that everyone, Gentile and Jew, can be brought into the family of God when they have faith in Jesus Christ. So Paul, he's writing this letter because he wants to remind them, and he didn't have these words, but John 3:16 comes to mind. For God so loved what? The world. He loved the whole world. God so loved the world that he gave his only son. They lost sight of their mission. And this is Gentile and Jewish believers alike. They lost sight of their mission in that church. And that's very reminiscent of Israel. The nation Israel forgot their mission time and time again. God called them to be a priestly people, a holy nation. And a priest's function is to be the light of God to the world, to bring others into the family of God. And they, time and time again, they messed that up. They thought that God had called them apart to be separate and holy and better than you. But instead, what he called them to be separate for was for the redemption of the world. They lost sight of that, the people of Israel. And then this church at Rome lost sight of their mission that God had called them to. And do you know, I might be talking a little fast, I don't know. Do you know that every church has the same mission? Whether it's stated or not, or I should say every church ought to have the same mission.
That's right.
To be Christ-like disciples who make Christ-like disciples. That's what God's called us to. To say that differently, the mission of the church is to continue the work that Jesus began and work for the redemption of the world. the whole world. To work for the redemption of the world. That's what God calls us to. That's what he called them to. And they lost sight of it. They started squabbling over little things. Little things became the big things, and then the mission just got pushed aside. And so Paul writes to them and he says, I have a missionary trip that I'm taking. I need to go to Spain because they need to hear this good news. And he invites this church at Rome to participate. I don't know if he wanted some of them to go with him or if he wanted them to fund it, but he knew that they needed this missionary trip as much, if not more, than the people Paul was going to. Because they need to be reminded. We lost sight of the big things. We lost sight of the one thing God has called us to be like him and help others to know him. And so he invites them on this trip, and then in verse 2 and 3. Paul says, I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart, for I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those of my own race, the people of Israel. Oh, I wish that I could give my life up. I would give up my very salvation if it meant that everyone was saved. I mean, that's how deep this is in Paul. So I wish I could lay my life down. But he knows that only Christ can lay his life down for the redemption of people. But and Paul's heartfelt cry here, what he's doing is inviting them to have that same desire. I wish that these dreams would come true. I'm going to work for these dreams to come true, that I could be like Christ, lay my life down so that others might be saved. Paul's telling them, here's the heart cry of the church. To desire that the whole world would be redeemed. To get back on mission. To be disciples who make disciples. And I think what happened was they got bored. I mean, they definitely had some tensions, but I think they got bored. And so they started to squabble over those little things. And they got so bored that they just lost sight of what Christ had called them to. And so Paul tells them, get back to what we need to be doing. So I want to ask you, what's the cry of this church's heart? What's the cry of this church's heart? Is it the mission of God to be disciples, Christ-like disciples who make Christ-like disciples? And I don't think it's to fill these seats. Hear me now. The mission is not to fill these seats. That's a good thing, and we want people to come to our churches. We ought to want them to come to our churches. I happen to think that Hope Church of the Nazarene is the best church in Battle Creek, and First Church is like just barely. But that's only because that's my church. I'm joking. This is a great church. We ought to love our church so much that we want people to come. But our mission isn't to fill these seats. Our mission is to go to lost people so that they might be found by Christ. That's our mission. To go to lost people so that they might be found by Christ. God has given us a mission far too compelling to spend time fighting over little things because people are perishing. People are perishing. And so we groan, as Paul said. We groan for the redemption of all of creation. And we're called to live cruciform lives, called to live lives like Christ, wishing that you could give yourself up for the sake of others. We're called to live the kingdom now. The kingdom of God out here and now in Battle Creek, to love our enemies, to bless those who persecute us, to see others as higher than ourselves, to give generously and with a gracious heart, to forgive, and then forgive, and then we think we've forgiven enough to forgive some more, and in all things, love. Folks, if we're truly groaning for the restoration of all things, and if we have a heart like Paul's, wishing that we could be cut off from Christ if it meant that others were saved, wouldn't we be willing to go? Wouldn't we be willing to go? I'm going to tell you something you already know. We live in a post-Christian world. The world isn't what it used to be. Some for the better, some for the worse. But people aren't coming here. That's a general statement. But for the most part, people who do not know Jesus Christ are not just walking through the door. The world isn't what it used to be. And so, I think this gives us perfect opportunity to live like Christ. What did Jesus do? He sat in heaven and waited for everything to happen. No, that's not what he did. He came to us. He took on flesh, made his dwelling among us. God went. He came to us. And so as the people of God, his family, he calls us to go. For the sake of the redemption of the world. Christ came for that purpose, and he calls us to go for that purpose. We go. We are the continuing incarnation of Jesus Christ for the sake of the redemption of the world because we have the Holy Spirit. So let's go. Let's go on mission with him. People are perishing. They don't have to. I watched a sermon by John Maxwell this week, and he said something that really struck a chord with me as I was preparing for this. He said, let me preface this. I think a lot of times when the pastor says, go, 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 maybe not quite like that, but we have to go, we think, well, yeah, we're to go to the world, we're not to be out of the world, but too often we see people go to the world and they become just like the world. And that worries us. But I love what Maxwell said. He says, I don't have to be like them to reach them, but I do have to like them to reach them. We don't have to be like the world to reach the world, but we sure do have to like the world to reach them. We have to love them. I would go farther and say we have to love the world to reach them. And by the world, I mean the people out there. And we pray for revival. Revival is going to happen through prayer and going. It's two-pronged. It doesn't just happen through prayer. That's the start. Well, we got to start there. But then it happens through prayer and going. Go. We go. Christ sends us. God has given us the very gift of salvation, the Holy Spirit. A loving act. So let us be the people whose hearts are so broken for the world, and I would say so broken for Battle Creek. So broken for Battle Creek that we go. We go to them. So has the mission of God so grabbed you? Are you captured as Paul was by the mission of God so much so that you're willing to be uncomfortable and go? Has God's kingdom so changed your life as that radical transformation, that death to sin and life in Christ so changed you that you're willing to forget about the little things and instead live into the call of the church, which is to give your life for the sake of the redemption of the world? That's what Christ did for us. May we groan. May we long. May we give up our lives so that others might be counted among God's family and know the changing power of Jesus Christ. Little things be the little things. Let's go on mission with God. That's what he's called us to. Well, we have an opportunity today, and it is a great privilege to share in the celebration of the Lord's Supper. And today, we can think about this in a lot of different ways. But today, here's what we're celebrating, that Christ comes to us. That's what we're celebrating. That Christ comes to us and gives us salvation. And as we take these elements, we're reminded that it is God who nourishes us. It is God who sustains us through the very power of Jesus Christ. And so we can go knowing that he goes with us. And so those who have agreed so graciously to help us receive communion, they're going to hand out the elements. You don't have to be a member here. You don't even have to be a Nazarene. If you believe that Jesus Christ has saved you, you can come and share in this meal. And if that's not what you believe, but today the Lord is speaking to you, and he's saying, this is for you, it's a gift for you. And today you can come and receive these elements and say, God, I want you to be mine. I want to go on mission with you. And if that's the case, you're welcome, all are welcome, to the Lord's table. And after you receive the elements, hold on to them. And I will lead us through a time, and I would ask you to reflect. And ask the Lord, where are you sending me? He might be sending you to the house next door. He might be sending you to the dinner table to your family member who doesn't know Jesus Christ. Let's not limit where he might be sending us. If you would hand out the elements. Father, you are so good to us. And we don't even have words to describe how thankful we are for the gift of salvation, that you saved us, and you didn't wait for us to to get to a certain level of goodness or holiness. But you came to us and you took on flesh. You had a real body, real blood. God came to us. Lord, you came to us and you came so that we might be set free from the bondage to sin and death, but made alive in Jesus Christ. So Lord, we celebrate that you came to us. And as we're reminded of that, we pray that it would be that same Lord who nourishes us, who sustains us, who blesses, who keeps us as we go on mission with you. So Lord, may our feet be ready, and may our mouths be ready to speak of the goodness of Jesus Christ. And in all things, may we be reminded that we needed a Savior. So as we go, we forgive just as we have been forgiven. And we speak boldly of the love of Christ. And we remember that on that night when you met with the disciples, you eagerly desired to share a meal with them. And you took the bread, and you broke it. You said, "This is my body, broken for you. May it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Take and eat. May the bread." He took the cup of the covenant, and in the same way, so this is my blood poured out for you, may it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life, take and drink. Lord, you are so good. Your love endures forever. May we be the church you called us to be, desiring to know you, to be like you, and that others might come into the family of God. May it be so. Amen. Amen. Would you stand for the benediction? Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.